Hey guys, today I've got a very special video that I want to share with you. I've been recently playing GTA 5 for PC, and I'm really enjoying it, like crazy amounts. It's a really great game, great optimization and everything. So I wanted to see what I could do to improve the game experience, like improve the frames per second or how far I could ramp up the graphics settings. So, obviously, to do that, you have to find out what's bottlenecking. So, I started the journey and I was trying to figure out what was bottlenecking, going online forums first. And GTA is an open world game, and that means the CPU does quite a lot of work, so it's quite a CPU intensive game. Obviously, it's brilliantly graphics-wise, but it's quite CPU intensive, like rendering pedestrians and draw distances and stuff like that. It's heavily dependent on the processor. Now, basically, I haven't upgraded my processor since I first got a gaming computer, like proper gaming computer. And the processor I've got is an AMD Phenom II 1090T. Now, it's quite an old processor. It's about 4 years old, I think. It came out in 2011, which makes it 4 years old. I've overclocked it to 3.8 gigahertz, and that's the stablest. That's the highest clock that I can get stable. I thought I could get it to 4 gigahertz, but apparently GTA is a better stress tester than Prime 95 or Intel burn test. So that told me that I needed to bring it down to 3.8 to make it stable, which is exactly what I did. So now it's stable at 3.8, no crashes at all with the game. If you guys have an overclock and have got crashes, and you haven't got crashes in Prime or Intel burn test, then trust me, it's probably your overclock which is causing the game to crash, or hard reset in my case, which happened a few times. Okay, so back on track. Old processor. My graphics card is an R9 280X. So it's pretty good, above the recommended specs by quite a long way. 7850 is recommended, I think. So there we go. And on the screen now, you can see my settings, the settings that I'll be using. So about like no MSAA, obviously, because that's a frame rate killer that just kills it on any card. I actually just fiddled around with it for fun and tried it on 8x MSAA, and there was. It looks way better on 8x MSAA than 2x, but there is basically no frame rate drop. The massive frame rate drop is from 0 to 2, and then it gets less exponentially. So there we go. Anyhow, regardless of that, I am going to be showing you the stock, my stock speeds, so the stock graphics card speeds of 1070 and 1600. This is the benchmark that that I ran, and these are the results I got. So as you can see, all we're really interested in is the top box of frames per second. Higher is better, and we're mainly looking at the right-hand side column. So 51, 60, 52, 67, 53. Those are the sorts of frame rates that I got during that benchmark. Now, I will be showing you a side-by-side comparison of the text files that the game outputs when you run a benchmark, so don't worry about that. So, I decided that instead of to find out how bad the bottleneck of my processor was on the graphics card, I thought, right, I could do it one of two ways. I could either overclock the processor to see how many extra frames I get, or underclock the GPU to see how many less frames I get. So obviously it's easier to downclock the GPU, so that's exactly what I did. And I started by using MSI Afterburner, as every avid overclocker does, and nothing was happening. Literally nothing was happening. You can see the results now on the screen. There's basically no difference. I tried it on 100 megahertz core less, 200 megahertz core less, 300 megahertz core less, nothing was happening. I was like, come on, MSI Afterburner must be broken or something. So I decided to use Catalyst Control Center. You can do much lower core clocks and memory clocks using Catalyst Control Center. than MSI Afterburner, because MSI Afterburner is not meant for underclocking, it's meant for overclocking, so why would they bother? So, I did it again on Catalyst Control Center, and as you can see on your screen, on the left is the stock at 1070 and 1600, and on the right is the underclocked scores. So as you can see, by dropping the core clock by 120 megahertz and the memory clock by 100 megahertz, nothing changed, absolutely nothing. In fact, the results were slightly better. Right, on to the next one. This is with a 850 clock and a 1400 memory, which means that it's now been dropped by 220 megahertz on the core and 200 megahertz on the memory. And as you can see, again, there are no differences. If anything, they're slightly better. So that means that currently my GPU is still not, my CPU is still the bottleneck. Right, so I decided let's go down a bit further. I started making the steps I went down a bit bigger. So here's 700 megahertz, so that's a 370 megahertz drop in core and a 400 megahertz drop in memory. And you can see it for yourself, the results are exactly the same, they haven't changed yet again. 700, that's 370 megahertz less on the core clock, that's ridiculous. Now, this is where things start to change. At 600 megahertz core, you can see that the frame rates are much more consistent, which means that the GPU is the bottleneck in the system. So you can see in the first result there wasn't much difference, but in the second result you can see that 7 FPS difference. Third result was basically the same. Fourth result you get a 6 FPS difference. And the last result you get a 2 FPS difference. Now, I did run this after I ran the lower clocks because I was trying to find out where exactly the CPU was being the bottleneck. So that this is the equilibrium position, or slightly under it, where the GPU is now the bottleneck. Now I thought to myself, let's just do it for fun, let's go a bit lower. So I went down to 550 megahertz on the core clock and 750 megahertz on the memory clock. And as you can see, first result doesn't change, second result 12 FPS, third result 2 FPS, this is ridiculous, it starts at zero. Okay, pass 3 is a 12 difference again, and pass 4 is 5 frames difference. So now you can see the GPU is, the CPU is outperforming the GPU. And I thought, why not do it for fun? Let's get up the idle clocks, like the lowest it can go. When there's no games running or it's just YouTube, the GPU downclocks itself to 300 core and 150 memory. I thought, let's run it, why not? As you can see, the results are quite drastic. There is a 30 FPS difference in the majority of them. And so it's 30 in pass 0, 40 in pass 1, 35 in pass 2, 50 in pass 3, and like 40, 30, 35 in pass 4. So there you can see it. My CPU is bottlenecking my GPU by quite a long way, so I can underclock my GPU. I can base nearly half the clocks on my GPU and still get the same performance I'm getting. 600 core and 900 memory is at the point at which the CPU starts like going, hey, I'm better than you. But apart from that, my god, I did not realize how bad it was. So that is an excuse for a processor upgrade. I'm probably going to wait till Zen. I want AMD to be good, but they're not at the moment, so I mean, I don't know how much an 8350 will be an improvement, because I can't guarantee an overclock. So I don't know how much of an improvement an 8350 will be on my 1090T. So if I can hold it out for another year and a bit, then maybe I'll pick up a Zen processor. And if Zen sucks, then sorry, AMD. The blue team is the winner. So yeah, those are the results. And yeah, feel free to leave your comments in the description. I'll be uploading a Gyazo link to my graphic settings, and yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you guys for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Hopefully it was very informative. And yeah, thanks for watching.